So how are you?
I'm very well.
You're an Angeleno. I did not know that until I was reading up on you for this.
Yeah.
How long have you been? 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
So did you make a decision that the work was in LA and I gotta go, or?
Well, what happened is I started coming here almost in a sort of prospective way. It started with a show I did called MI5. It was called Spooks in the UK. And it gained a degree of popularity here. So we would come out and do press for it anytime it was about to air here. And my wife and I were thinking, well, is LA a possibility? For me, as an actor, the actors I consistently aspired to in terms of the work they were doing and the platform on which they were doing it, they were here. You know, if going back, it was Sidney Poitier, going forward, it was Denzel Washington, and even great actors like Daniel Day-Lewis, you know, they were getting to the sandbox that they were playing in that I really aspired to was here. So then I did a film called Last King of Scotland, which also did pretty well here, and it just started sort of opening my mind to it. So we took a punt and applied for green cards, got them, and so we had two kids, and we realized if you don't do it now, it's going to get a little traumatic for them to leave.
Exactly.
So they were 5 and 2 when we moved, and I'm so glad we did it when we did, because it was in 07, and if we'd left it a year when we went on to have the economic crash and that sort of epic writer's strike, I don't think we would have done it. So it was just about the right time.
So were you an ambitious young actor from the beginning? Did you always see the whole picture? Or because you started, it's been a long career for a guy who's still as young as you are.
Right. Ambitious, yes. But I think a sense of what I want to do and wanted to do is more the reality of it. There was a definite glass ceiling in the UK when it came to actors of color. I had had an incredible run with the Royal Shakespeare Company, with the show MI5, and it just started to become apparent after that trajectory that there was a limit to what was achievable. A lot of what we do in the UK at that time anyway was period drama, and there were no real indicators of what a black British actor goes on to achieve beyond a degree of notoriety in the UK, exclusively in the UK. And so I didn't want to wait to have my suspicions confirmed. And so a combination of what was going on with me familiarly, with my, like I say, where my kids were at age-wise, and it just felt like the right gamble to make, and it turned out to be exactly that.
Well, it's funny because this movie is another colorblind casting situation.
Right.
Doing Les Mis and having you as Javert is not controversial, really. It's funny how it's in 5 years or so of this movement happening. It doesn't feel controversial to me watching the movie, and yet you went through this with the King cycle, I guess, with the Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yeah,
where you won awards, but you were still kind of.
Yeah.
Being poked at.
It's been incredibly interesting for me because playing Henry VI at the Royal Shakespeare Company, I was completely oblivious to the fact that that was going to be significant. I didn't know I was the first black actor to be afforded that opportunity at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it blew up in the press, and very thankfully with that situation, it was well received. And so I think it went on to become something that opened things up for other people and normalized it. And that's something that was very gratifying. You mentioned 5 years ago, I was in the red hot eye of that with Selma, and that starting Oscar So White, and it very clearly being a period in time where we still weren't there yet in relation to representation, both in front of and behind the camera. And then 5 years on, not only with people of color, but women as well, how there's been such a huge paradigm shift, and it has brought around exactly what I always hoped would be the case ultimately. We're not there yet, but we're on our way to normalizing these things, whereby it is less of a noteworthy thing to have a woman directing a giant movie or heading up a giant movie and it not being called a chick flick. You know, by virtue of having black people predominantly in a film or a TV piece doesn't make it black TV or black film. You know, these are all things that I think are changing because the press, the audience, are holding the gatekeeper's feet to the fire and saying, no, that's not how we perceive it. We're going to go and see it. We want it to give us more of it. And so therefore, it's normalizing it.
I always think people don't really care. I mean, in the end,
absolutely,
there's a small group of people who have strong feelings, whether
right.
bad or good or whatever, on either end of the spectrum. But really, people just want to be entertained. They want to see
right.
their shows. They want to see their movies. And, you know, if it was White Panther, and it was as well-directed and well-acted, they would
right.
still love it.
Right.
Yeah,
but we've had White Panther.
Yes, we've had a lot of White Panther.
For a century.
Yeah.
But what happened is that we had gatekeepers telling us that people don't want Black Panther, or other countries don't want
right.
that, and there isn't a market for it, there isn't an audience for it. And I think you're absolutely right. People, by and large, don't care, but it's a supply and demand
right.
thing. You know, if you keep on supplying the same thing, it looks like there's a demand for it. When you give some people something fresh, and you combine that with social media, where lots of people have a platform to say, more please, then that is where the true paradigm shift has taken place, I think.
Well, I also think it's different for different kinds of markets. So, you know, a movie like, you know, some of your smaller movies,
mm-hmm.
probably in the indie market in certain countries, I mean, there's certain countries that are even more biased than America when it
right.
comes to this issue. It's real,
mm-hmm.
no matter how angry it makes Franklin Leonard,
right.
Who gets very angry at me about this conversation, but, you know, it's a very... it's a dicey thing, but on indie film. But then you go to the bigger films, or, you know, like comedies don't necessarily translate, no matter what they are,
mm-hmm.
to other countries. So there's all these different rules, these different structures that have nothing to do with race.
Yeah.
And some of them do, and some of them don't.
I don't know that I entirely agree, because what it is that, you know, I grew up in Nigeria, where, or a significant part of my youth was in Nigeria, and if you are being fed a certain thing,
right.
it shapes your taste. What happens when you get something new is initially you may think, what's that? All of us react,
mm-hmm.
sometimes, most of the time, adversely to change. But if it is presented to you enough and you are open-minded enough on the basis of experience, your palate changes.
Right.
And that, I think, is the thing that those countries that we relegate to being, okay, they are not there, they don't like X, they don't like Y, they don't like Z, it's because they haven't actually had the opportunity to be educated, to have their ignorance eroded by experience. I have seen palpably that prejudice is broken down by a level of understanding that comes through just experience. And that is when you say, it's not going to work in Germany, Chinese people are going to... It's because they haven't had the opportunity.
Right.
Not everyone's a bigot. And that's learnt behavior, by the way. So how do we, as content creators, help the world just be exposed to something different? Ultimately, there are going to be bigots, there are going to be people who you can't please all people
right.
all the time. But that's the thing, is give them the opportunity on the basis of their own taste to embrace it or reject it.
Well, I think that's the hope of streaming, ultimately.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'm a big believer in theatrical,
absolutely.
But I think streaming will open up, and for America too, we'll actually see film that is not the one most popular film from France or the
right.
one popular film from this country,
right.
but we'll actually get a taste for everything, or at least have the opportunity to.
It's already happened.
Yeah.
It's democratized things. You know, things that wouldn't otherwise be made are being made because it's not a slave to the gatekeepers who say, okay, look at the box office for X film. That means we can't do it again.
Right.
Well, the fact that a lot of these streamers very cleverly don't use those as barometers of success means that you're not a slave to it. You can just put content on there and people can come to it when they want. And, you know, if we were making this version of our limited series of Les Mis for film, there would be a lot more pressure on the casting, on so many choices we have made that are not there because it's a limited series for television and has been sold all around the world, very enthusiastically embraced all around the world in a way that we probably would be dictated to if it were film, that's not the way to go.
Mm. It's an interesting challenge. So back in Nigeria,
yeah.
Were you an actor as a kid? Were you have aspirations to that as a kid? Or when did you get the taste for this?
It's so funny. Things have really changed. Even just talking to you now, I'm so heartened by the change I have been afforded to see in my own lifetime. When I was growing up in Nigeria, the idea of a young Nigerian kid going on to be an actor was very far away. I mean, even though we have a very robust film industry in Nigeria, Nollywood, as it's popularly known, if you had parents who, like mine, were typically Nigerian, academia is what they aspire to, and therefore you aspire to, and acting, that's not a proper job. The arts, generally, not proper. So no, it wasn't. What happened with me, I was born in the UK, we moved back to Nigeria when I was 6, and then we moved back to the UK when I was 13. And it's when I came back to the UK that I fell into this youth theatre because I fancied a girl who took me to a group and I thought it was a date, it was actually a youth theatre. And I developed this love for it. I never thought it was something I was going to ultimately go on to do professionally, but I just couldn't shake it as something I had a passion for.
Was there a moment or a role or thing that where it clicked for you?
There was a teacher. There was a teacher I had who, in, I guess, the equivalent of middle school, said to me, "You have something." And I wouldn't say this to all of my students, but I think you should really consider doing this to a greater degree. And ultimately, she helped me with my applications for drama school and auditioning, and actually even sent me to the youth theatre where I ended up meeting my wife, my future wife. And I got a scholarship to go to the London Academy of Music and Dramatic Art. That's the only way I would have been able to train because my parents couldn't have afforded to send me to drama school, and that's how it happened.
So the encouragement of a teacher was everything.
Absolutely. Jill Foster.
It's not enough. People don't acknowledge that enough because it really, somebody telling you could do it is so much.
Any art form, it's unfortunate because I think this is why actors and artists generally are crazy. It's because they are very, it's very difficult to gauge if you're good. And the only way you can do that is by the opinion of others, because it's entirely subjective. You know, I can watch a performance and think it's great, you could watch the same performance and think it's terrible. And the only way that person keeps on going is if just enough of the right people tell them they're good and encourage them. Otherwise, to get in front of a camera and to deign to say, "I'm going to evoke humanity for the screen," requires a lot of confidence, a lot of self-belief to do it well and convincingly. And that tends to be, ideally, a handful of people whose opinions you trust is what gives you that confidence.
So was there a moment where you, as an actor, felt like, okay, I figured this out, or I have some sort of sense of the groove, or
I don't think that ever happens. It's a question of degrees. You on the basis of experience, you gain a bit more confidence, you gain a bit more bravery, and you do it that bit much more well, I think, as a result. Theatre, for me, is the best way to do that, because every night you have another opportunity in front of an audience to fail. And there is a connection between the actor and the audience where you can feel in the room, atmospherically, whether it's working or not. Mm. And you are able to make slight corrections, slight modulations every night that helps you to know what works for them and what works for you. And ultimately, I do think that is by and large where really good actors are formed, is in that sort of hotbed of the unspoken exchange between an audience and the actors as to whether I feel like and they feel like the truth is being told.
It feels like in England you're a bit more of a public figure. In America, it's interesting because I didn't realize you had 4 kids, for instance.
Right.
Before I was looking into you, I mean, it's. I don't think people see you. I don't think that's the image that has been developed as, David Oyelowo's and his family, the family man.
Right.
Is that intentional, or are they separate? Do you keep them separate on purpose, or is it just we don't go out to the right parties, or?
I definitely don't go out to the right parties. I'm on a set or at home, by and large. I mean, and that's where I'm happy and comfortable. I'm a big believer in the idea of my job, what I aspire to do, is very dependent on the audience's ability to put David the person aside and buy into whichever character I'm playing. So it's not that I'm hiding my family or my wife or my own personal situation away. It's I don't necessarily lead with that, and I don't think it's a tricky balance, isn't it? And it's getting more and more so in this world of celebrity and how you navigate a public life. The more you give, the more you have to expect that people are going to feel ownership of your personal life. So I think you can't be surprised if you push your personal life into people's faces and then they feel the need, the desire, the right to pick at it or be involved in it or to take a look at it. So, and I don't want that for my kids. I want that to be their choice if they want to have a public life. So, I kind of believe in the philosophy of let the work do the talking.
So you came to the LA, and in 2015 was it kind of an explosive year,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
For you? I mean, there was a lot going on. Plus, the movie that ended up being on HBO,
right?
Which was essentially a one man show,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All happening kind of in the same year. Mm-hmm. Was that head turning? Were you just too busy working on the next thing to think about it too much, or?
It was and it wasn't. It was head turning in that. It was definitely a huge spike in my career to date. The combination of Selma and Nightingale, two films that were very well received, but they had...
Wasn't there a third film that same?
Oh, probably.
Yeah. Oh, the Butler.
Oh, the Butler.
Which
yeah.
Another
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and the Butler had been before that. It's funny. The public perception and the personal perception with any given film, any career trajectory, they're so different, the public and the personal.
Mm-hmm.
The Butler was actually a tricky ride. We had this whole controversy around, is it the Butler or is it Lee Daniels, the Butler? And that became this thing that, rather than it being about the film, it became this whole thing of, why is it called that, and da, da, da. So
also you had this issue of all these white stars and a movie, and you had, Forrest obviously in the lead, so you had some stars of color, but you also was like this weird, it was really like on the cutting edge of that moment.
Yeah.
In terms of all that issue.
It was the cutting edge, it was the moment, because we had, in that year, I think we had the Butler, we had, was that the year of 12 Years a Slave? I can't remember. But I remember there being a year where it was 12 Years a Slave, Mandela, Fruitvale Station, and maybe it was the Butler. And what we were in the middle of then was a very clear atmosphere of there can only be one, and whereby, which is the black film that is going to rise, which is just so egregious as a narrative that whether people were admitting it or not was in the air. So we had that with that film, and then Selma came along and was incredibly successful and has been seen by so many people. But we then got mired in this controversy of, was it accurate? We basically, a hit job was done on us by another studio who will remain nameless, where a story was planted about, this historian came out and said, Selma was LBJ's idea, not Dr. King's idea. And that narrative was allowed to fester and take, which is just so crazy to be, what? This is silly. And then it lingered enough that it kind of became a narrative around the film. It became this controversial film. And it went on to birth Also So White. So that was kind of dicey. And then Nightingale, which we had made as a film for theatrical release, got turned down by every festival and every distributor. And it wasn't until the lovely...
Richard was actually here, and we did one of these interviews before it got picked up by HBO.
Oh, really?
So, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So the way what happened with that one is that it sat on the shelf for a while. Thankfully, the LA Film Festival, the lovely Stephanie Elaine, programmed it, got great reviews, and I was in the middle of all the stuff with Selma. Jeremy Kloner and Dee Dee Gardner at Plan B saw it, loved it, and helped take it to HBO, and then it became something that we never could have envisaged. I was shooting The Queen of Katwe in Uganda, and people started sending me texts of my giant head on billboards along Sunset. I was going, how? So what was going on behind the scenes and how it felt compared to, it's so interesting the life films go on to have beyond the moment which Hollywood so values, which is the box office and the accolades and all of that. You know, those films have all gone to transcend what that, you know, the things that felt important at the time. And again, I think that's to do with streaming. I think that's to do with how accessible films are to people beyond that moment, which is opening weekend and the first, I guess, window where people get to see a film.
So, I mean, on Queen of Katwe, were you and Lupita both, was there a sense of consciousness of all this stuff going on at home around both of your careers and this kind of building thing? Because the movie is very peaceful and zen.
Which one?
Katwe.
Oh, yes. Oh, gosh. Well, that was really interesting because Lupita and I had become friends because it was 12 Years a Slave and The Butler were in the same kind of award season, so we kept on bumping into each other, and it was really amazing to see someone who could completely pass for a corn seller in Uganda uprising to that kind of stardom in Hollywood. And I had, you know, this kind of crazy moment with Selma, and there we were in the slums of Uganda doing this film, and we're both very proud Africans, and so it just meant a lot to us to get to do that film, and that Disney were the ones making it. So the feeling on that, and with the wonderful Mira Nair directing as well, the feeling was we have been given a platform, we have been given an opportunity
to show more of who we are. We work in Hollywood, and I guess the perception is, okay, we're now gonna do what are quote unquote Hollywood films, but here we are in a place that is of so much import to us and that we want to see the world embrace in a different way, that is not just about corruption and genocide and, you know, we are gonna tell the story of an 11-year-old girl who's a genius. And so I think the feeling of that was just one of huge pride and desire to get it right.
So how do you, on a role like that, on any of your roles really, how do you do the work? I mean, do you look at dailies of yourself? Do you like a lot of prep? Are you do you go back and do a lot of research? What is your, how do you approach something like that?
I only watch dailies when I'm producing something, and that's, I don't know that it's very healthy to watch dailies of yourself because, you know, as an actor, it's very, very hard to be objective around your own performance. You ideally want to leave that in the hands of people you trust to put your performance together in a way that is not steeped in your own vanity and self-consciousness. The key is preparation. The key is knowing that character better than anyone else and then being emotionally available on the set to what the director wants, what the other actors are giving you, and to perpetually be interested in what feels true. How can I tell the truth of this scene, of this character, of this story?
And are you servicing the director primarily? I mean, is that your...
That's the job.
You going?
That's the job. I mean, you learn that in the theater, and I think that that's something that sometimes can be lacking in film. And creates for, I think, dysfunction and not very good movies when you are there to serve your own agenda. How do I look? Where's the light? Do I look good in it? You know, put that aside, you know, serve the story, serve the character, serve the audience ultimately. And that's something that I learned at drama school. I learned doing tiny plays because that's all you have. Right. You know, no one cares about whether you're a star or how much money you're earning or what the opening weekend is going to be. All you have is how good that show is on that night.
So are there times when you have to work past a director who's not as there?
That's the situation you work tirelessly to avoid. And I've had them, you know, and unfortunately, what you want is to feel free to take risks. And the only way to do that is to be in an arena that feels safe because someone has your back, ideally the director. If you don't feel that, what tends to happen is you act in a bubble. You feel the need to protect yourself, so you can't take big risks. So you're going to give a less interesting performance because you're hedging. You're doing just what you can to not come off as an idiot in this thing that looks like it's going to be a car crash. Mm. It hasn't happened often because I vet my directors quite fastidiously. And I don't mean I audition them. I talk to them. I look at their work. I, where possible, find out about what they're like to work with. And then you, okay, I feel able to put myself in this person's hands. It hasn't always worked out, and I'm very rarely wrong when it comes to the person who wasn't an ideal person to trust.
And you can feel when something's working on set?
It's insecurity. When something
besides the director, I mean, when there are these moments that are magical that everybody then remembers.
Oh, things are working.
When I thought you meant
when they're not working. When they're not working, it tends to be to do with a huge amount of insecurity, either from the director, which then becomes contagious and everyone doesn't really know what they're doing, and then it's a car crash. Yes, you can feel when it's working. And that's because regardless of how it's ultimately going to be received, you can feel that what drew you to the project initially is what is manifesting, and maybe even better, because you can feel it. You can feel when the grip and the best boy and the camera operator, when things stop and you go, whoa, okay, I think we told the truth with that scene, moving on. You can really feel when it's not working as well. And sometimes, I mean, the beauty of film, sometimes you can fix it. You can go in the edit, you can have very, very intelligent, wise, talented people who can make something out of nothing or out of a mess. And I've seen that happen as well. So sometimes
they can mess it up.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, yeah. Well, that's to do with dysfunction. If the studio wants one thing, the director wants one thing, the producer wants one thing, the actor who's very powerful wants one thing, and everyone is diverging, there's just no way. There's no way for anything good to come out of that. At some point, someone has to come along and go. And unfortunately, if it's the studio, that tends not to go very well. If it's a director who really knows what they're doing and they're given carte blanche to do that, you have a real chance. Sometimes it's a great producer who really has a handle on what a film should look like. And that tends to be when it's a less experienced director. Sometimes that needs to happen. Mm-hmm. But, you know, a lot of the time, once it's gone to that place, it's pretty ugly.
A strong voice seems like it's always that inevitable in any good film, is that somebody had a very strong voice.
And ideally it's the director, which is why working with the best is every actor's dream, you know, because ultimately films are not just creative, they're also political. And a film can get ruined by the politics that go on behind the scenes. So if you have a really strong voice in the director, sometimes you have a chance of circumnavigating that.
So is this why you decided to be a producer as well? Or?
Yes, absolutely. Because I work really, really hard to try to tell the truth with my performance, and I really love storytelling. And I'm not for one second saying I have all the answers, but what I do find egregious is when you do that work, you leave it in the hands of people who maybe are not as invested, maybe have their own agenda, or aren't just very good at what they do. Mm-hmm. And so to have a voice at the table has become important for me, but also when it comes to representation. I think, you know, the thing that Selma taught me is perspective matters. I watched that film go through the eyes of two white male directors, two black male directors, and then a female director, ultimately Ava DuVernay, who directed it. And it changed with each person's perspective on the basis of their own experience. Not to say any of the versions that were going to be made by any of those people was erroneous, but it changed. And that's important. And if you've only had one point of view for so long, that has a cultural impact. And so for me, it's about, okay, a woman who's black, who's of a certain age and from a certain place, is going to mean that this piece of work is going to have a certain feel, indisputable. So approaching Amar Asante to direct a film I produce called A United Kingdom was very conscious because she was of Ghanaian descent, she had grown up in the UK, she was highly intelligent and very talented. And so her version of a film about a Botswanan prince who falls in love with a white woman and he gets denied his own leadership in his country is going to be very different than the myriad of white British male directors who were being proposed for that film. And it proved to be true. So that's where, for me as a producer, the real change can come.
So there's something like Belle, which covers similar territory of certainly cultural mixing, influential in that regard? Or are you looking at the how she worked, what looks like as a director, her style? Or
it's execution. I thought the execution of Belle was very, very good. Sometimes, and more often than not, if a director has done a certain thing, they want to run in the opposite direction for their next thing. Right. So I knew Amma. We had worked together several years prior, and I approached her with this to see. You know, yes, she had navigated similar territory, completely different era, and the political landscape was completely different. But you see, the thing is, as a person of color, what happens is Tom Cruise can do as many action movies as he wants. Tom Hanks can play as many historical characters as he wants, as well as Benedict Cumberbatch. And it's never highlighted because the sandbox for them is vast. When it comes to a director of color or an actor of color, everything you do gets scrutinized to a greater degree because it's so often groundbreaking, if it's any good, or if you're being given a bigger platform to do it. So any historical figure I go on to play is going to, oh, wow, you're the historical figure guy because you played Martin Luther King. But that, you know, the amount of historical figures Leonardo DiCaprio has played and will go on to play will never be questioned because the world is his oyster. And that's great. For him. But the reason I say that is that we're still not there yet for Amar Asante, for me. And so even though Belle and A United Kingdom both looked at mixed race relationships, they couldn't be more different in a sense outside of that very specific commonality. She saw that, I saw that, and thankfully it didn't become a reason why she didn't entertain the idea of doing it. But yes, it's not just purely about the color she is and what story she's told. Is she brilliant? You know, for me, that was a passion project for me for 7 years. I would much rather go for an orange person if you know, or a green person, whatever, if they're brilliant. But like I say, perspective. Do you have an experience that is personal to you that is going to manifest in passion that will then manifest in how well you're able to execute that story?
Well, it's also interesting that you chose as a producer to make a movie where you're the kind of rock center, but the woman, the other character, is the one that's really going through the journey.
Right.
Through a lot of the movie. I mean, it's really, a lot of it's about her more than it is really about you, and yet you decided that was what you wanted to do anyway. It wasn't the David Oyelowo movie.
That's perspective. Because for me, he's the one. He's the one who left his country. He was going to be king of Botswana. He's the one who has the arc of transformation in the sense that he is the one who's exiled. He is the one who falls in love with this woman who's not meant to. He's the one who goes on to become the president of his country, having been exiled from his country. And that's exactly why I love movies. You see something, mm-hmm. I see something, anyone else sees something different. What has happened in the past with an African narrative is that we have very firmly placed it in the white purview. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the idea of a white savior movie is to do with that's the entry point. And that was one of the challenges of mm-hmm. developing that movie. I was working with white folks who had a perspective on what it's like for a white woman to be in an African context because they didn't have the experience of what it's like for a black African right. to be in a white British context, which I had. And so I was able to bring balance to it, and Amma was able to bring balance to it by virtue of our experience. So you're gonna get something out of it because of the character that you glom onto. I know for a fact that you have never seen an African prince falling in love who goes on to be a great leader for his nation on film.
Right.
You haven't seen that before. And so that's why it's important that I am at the table with the decision making and that Amma is in the driving seat with how that narrative gets told, because trust me, outside of that, it would be entirely
through and the thing is, I don't disagree with your perception of the character and how right. it all fits together, but you could have also, as a producer and a star, made it more about you. Right. I mean, the character is stoic
right.
to a degree to which Rosamund's character is not.
Right.
And that kind of leads to that a little bit. I mean, you could have, in a movie with Tom Cruise, you know, would have said, okay, ramp up those couple scenes so I can be more dramatic.
Right.
Or a bigger presence or whatever.
Right.
Which you showed restraint as a producer.
But if you watch Edge of Tomorrow, whose film is that? Is that?
That's a good question. It's hers.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But it isn't.
It's one of the reasons it's one of his best films.
Well,
in recent years, is because he let it go. He didn't force himself into. I mean, maybe other people force him into it, but whatever. Right.
Yeah. But my point is, it's hers, but it's his.
Right.
But it's hers.
Yeah.
And that's what's great about the film. That's what I want to see in film. I don't need to sort of mandates to the audience, this is a David Oyelowo movie, I am a star, and so therefore you will look at me whether you want to or not. What is the story? What makes the story its best self? And, you know, I love Edge of Tomorrow because it is a Tom Cruise movie, but it's also an Emily Blunt movie. You know, I think United Kingdom is both. Mm-hmm. You know, and depending on if you're a woman, you're going to feel differently. Depending if you're a man, if you're a black... You cannot tell any black male African that is Rosamund Pike's movie.
Right.
Because who, you know, we go to the movies to see ourselves. And I, and most black people my age or people of color my age have been forced to transpose themselves onto a white male character because that's all we had. So you go, okay. So there I am, the young kid with an afro, trying to put an S curl into my afro, you know, which is like, what are you doing? Now, my kids don't have to do that. They have Chadwick, they have Michael B. Jordan, they have, do you know what I mean? That's the beauty of the truth of representation on film behind and in front of the camera.
And really hard, I think, for white people to understand.
Absolutely.
And absolutely. Just the challenge of it
absolutely
doesn't exist.
Absolutely, which is why I think the importance is less about understand. My job is normalize. Mm. Normalize the fact that you have the blessing of seeing yourself in an 11-year-old girl from Uganda who plays chess. That has been the greatest thing for me with that film. I was at an airport a year ago or so, and a grandfather, this white guy, came up to me in the lounge and said, thank you so much for Queen of Katwe, because I have 9 granddaughters, and I've taught them all to play chess, and we now watch that film once a month. That's a lot.
Yes.
But we watch
not
that
for a nine-year-old.
Right, right. We watch that film once a month because we're so inspired by it, and it has values in it that I want to teach my granddaughters. Mm-hmm. And he was from, I think, the Midwest or something, you know, and that's a film fully steeped in and authentic to a Ugandan slum. And he was able to see his granddaughters in that 11-year-old girl. Mm. That's what I'm talking about.
And are, I won't even go down that road. I was going to ask whether you are this issue of the white savior or the magic Negro or whatever arguments there are, which seem to be to me in direct conflict with each other, is an issue for you as a film goer or as an observer of?
They're not in conflict with each other because they're tropes.
Right.
They are, and they are only tropes based on how often they are wheeled out. If we get to the point where what's normalized is people in general being represented in a complex, comprehensive, indisputably varied way, those tropes can exist. They won't even be labeled as such. It's because they are perpetually wheeled out, whether it's the best friend or the white savior trope or the magical Negro trope. It's only because they are consistently inserted into the films to serve the perpetuation of a certain narrative, which is what engenders white privilege, which is what makes, you know, a white person go, yeah, that's the world is my oyster.
Right.
Well, the world is my oyster. You just don't know it yet, but it is for me. And I just, you know, the work, the films, the TV, just need to get to the point whereby that is more of a reality than an aspiration.
Well, I always think that the answer is always in simplicity, not complexity.
Right.
Because ultimately what's popular is always going to be relatively simplistic.
Right.
But it's normalizing the things within it. And, you know, also I always say that you'll know that, I got in a lot of trouble for this, so I probably shouldn't even say it, but like when Ava's movie did not do so well at Disney, that the success for Ava would be getting the next movie as a white director in that position would.
Right.
Not so much whether her movie failed or succeeded at Disney.
Right. I actually couldn't agree more with that comment, because what we also are often denied the right of is the right to fail. I should have, as an artist, the right to fail. For my last piece of work, if we're going to make this a level playing field, to not be my last piece of work if it doesn't do well, because that doesn't work, generally speaking. A white male director can fail time and time again and be given several more shots. Same thing with actors. And I think that's because it's an acknowledgement, or it should be because it's an acknowledgement that it's an artistic endeavor. That's not the reality. The reality is that a lot of the folks giving those opportunities time and again are basically seeing themselves in those people who they're giving opportunities time and again, and they want those opportunities time and again. If I'm a white studio exec who wants several shots and I don't want to be fired on the basis of failure, then I want to share that with my bros. And the truth of the matter is that can get changed when it's not someone who looks like you, which is why when it comes to representation, it's also about who are the decision makers. Got to change that up. Got to be, you know, more people of color in those decision maker situations, because they're all going to exercise their own bias. We're all guilty of that, of exercising. When I make a United Kingdom, I'm exercising my own bias. Let's make no bones about it. You know, when I come on as a producer of Les Misérables and I say, look, guys, I'm not going to be a token in this limited series, let us do what we have hitherto not done, which is to make it pervasive. Let's actually tell the truth of what life was like in Europe 200 years ago, rather than what we've done over the last few decades, which is to paint it white. Mm-hmm. Black people, brown people.
British accent.
Sorry, say that again?
Usually with a British accent, right, instead of a French one.
Right. Exactly. That's the point exactly. If we were really, you know, being faithful to Victor Hugo, then no one should ever make Les Misérables but in French. But as creators of content, what we do is make things that we hope are going to be relevant to a wide audience that we want to speak to. Well, I'm that audience. And a lot of people who look like me and less like me and who are not my gender are also that audience. So let's serve them. And I think that the way to do that is to be very intentional about who get to make the decisions and that they are allowed to exercise their own bias on the basis of what they also want to see.
The stat that I came out of during Oscar So White that I still think is significant and is changing, interestingly, is that in the studio, a given year of studio movies, there are only 5 or 6 directors that are new, first-time studio directors, in any given year.
Right.
Wow. So the window to get in was already so narrow that the idea of new people, whether of color or females or whatever, was already being limited. And that had to be expanded, or that we had to kind of like force the issue and make that group exclusively some other groups that have not been in before in order to get the industry seated.
Yeah.
Essentially.
I am so proud of Cheryl Boone Isaacs. She took a lot of flack when that was all happening, but indisputably the demographics of the Academy has changed, and I absolutely know that has reflected the nominations and what films get to be celebrated. And I encourage the Academy, I'm part of the Academy, I'm part of the executive branch of the actors at the Academy, and I know, because I'm part of those discussions, but I encourage them to keep going because it serves our business. You know, it makes our business relevant, not just to a very small demographic, but to the world, you know, bringing in international actors, actors of color, all different ages. You know, it used to be that if you were under 30, the idea of you being in the Academy was just like impossible. That has changed, and it's manifesting in the films that we all get to celebrate.
Though, not to start a bigger argument or start another story, but one of the frustrating things for me about the expansion has been that there's been a limited number of Black Americans who've been able to get in. And I think the Academy has some responsibility to say that and to express the fact that that's been a very difficult thing for them to fulfill as much as they want to, because they clearly want to, but that the internationalism and all that has helped in a lot of other ways, but that they have not really been able to succeed because they're not enough Black Americans in the industry in terms of actors of certain stature and behind the camera and everything else.
Well, this goes back to what I was saying earlier. You know, one of the reasons I felt the need to move to Hollywood is because that was where I saw evidence of success and those to whom and to which I could aspire to. And I think if we are able to think beyond the immediate and think generationally, so much of any kind of aspiration you or I have is based on what we see going ahead of us. And I think the more success, the more expansion, even though it may not be as fast as we would like when it comes to female representation, people of color, regard whatever orientation people have, the more and more evidence there is of that for the next generation coming, the more likely they are to go, actually, I want to do that. And I have a North Star to aim for. So while I agree with you, and while so much of what makes all of this stuff egregious is because it's been allowed to fester for so long, real change, real systemic change takes time. But the thing that I know indisputably is that there is enough of a paradigm shift that I think it's going to be tough to walk it back. Mm-hmm. And that is huge, because what we've had hitherto is that, we can celebrate the tokens and it gives an excuse for us all to kind of go into apathy and lethargy for another 10 years before the next, spike. And I don't mean Lee, I mean Spike, Spike in terms of...
Well, there was Spike Jonze before him, so...
There you go.
But yeah. The funny thing is, I don't think anybody really wants to walk it back. I mean, there are people who do, and there are people who are bad and all that. But I mean, I think that they just were lazy, as you say. There was an apathy about it, and there was not a... And once the industry... Once there are 10 female directors in the studio a year, the next year there will be 15, because even though half of them will fail in their movies, specific movies, but people will get used to the idea of them being in the room.
I don't agree.
No?
I think there are people who would deep down want to walk it back because they've got to share. They've got to share in more of the pot. There can sometimes be a perception that your success, your expansion is a threat to my piece of the puzzle, especially if you have had carte blanche for so long, you know, and that's just human nature. So my thing about all of this progress is vigilance. Let's not kid ourselves that the ground that is being taken is being happily given. Mm. That there is a sandbox, and it has been occupied by a certain demographic for a long time. If things are opening up, it's just the reality. Yeah. That it therefore means that if you've been operating in a certain privilege, you now have to, it's going to be more egalitarian. It's going to be more of not just a given that you get certain opportunities, you've got to fight for it. And that's good. That creates good work. It creates a healthy environment. It means that, you know, the people are going to see female perspective, male perspective, black perspective, Mexican perspective, Chinese perspective. That's mm-hmm. amazing. But it's been so egregiously one-sided for so long. So, you know, let's not kid ourselves. Yeah. There are people who don't love all of this progress, but that's fine, because like I say, it is human nature, and it takes a while to realize actually what's yours is yours, what's mine is mine, and just do the work. Yeah. And the cream will rise.
Well, Trump did follow Obama. So, and of course, and I do think there'll be a tightening in the industry, certainly new content in a couple of years.
You're right.
And we'll see how much fighting there is then. So
yeah, yeah.
So Javert.
Yes.
Intimidating going into that, or did you think twice about it? Was it just offered to you? Was that how it started, or?
It was offered to me, but of course, you know, you have a knee-jerk response. So when I heard Les Misérables, of course, I was thinking of Tom Hooper's movie mm-hmm. from, was it 6-7 years ago now, which I really enjoyed, and I thought, you know, was very well executed. So my question immediately is, why do we need another one? And then I read Andrew Davies's adapted scripts from Victor Hugo's novel, mm-hmm. and I saw very quickly why this was going to occupy a different space. You know, as much as I love the musical, it's 2 or so hours long, mm-hmm. and it can only afford a primary colors look at this incredible story. I mean, if you read the book, it's 1,500 pages long. It's very dense, and he goes really deep into the politics, the class infrastructure, the war, the topography of the ground, the smell of the grass, the feel of a doorknob. I mean, he goes deep, and there's no way with a film or a theatrical experience with songs that you're going to be able to get that level of depth. So, you know, you come to Javert, okay, by and large seem to be the villain of the piece, the antagonist. But when you read the book, and certainly when I read the scripts, that wasn't so easy a label to be attributed to that character. He had complexity, he had depth. I got to understand some of the psychology behind his obsession. And that felt like a real opportunity for me mm-hmm. to go deep on a character that people think they know, but may get a degree of revelation on the basis of what we were about to do.
So is it all there in the script when you get it? I mean, is that what you, did you see that opportunity because the script was thorough, or?
Well, that's when you jump right in, is when he's a master. I mean, Andrew Davies, I mean, the book he did before this was War and Peace. I mean, who does that? Who goes from War and Peace to Let Me? I mean, that's just, I struggled to read the book, let alone adapt it. So he is truly brilliant at what he does. I mean, I remember being way younger and watching his limited series of Pride and Prejudice, seminal, you know, with Colin Firth.
Which amazingly people still bring up as the one they love. Years
yeah.
later, and in America, where yeah. it did not get as much profile as in the UK and the rest
right.
of the world.
Right.
And yet, when I talk to people about Pride and Prejudice, that's the one they always point out.
It was brilliant.
Yeah.
It was absolutely brilliant. And it's largely down to his talent for executing these adaptations. So, yes, it was there. And like I say, for me, it was about, okay, what does me plus this equal? And partly why I moved to Hollywood is because those are the kind of opportunities I wasn't getting. But I'm a big believer in leaving the door open behind you. Like, there's no point me being the one and then there being a dearth. And so the only pause I had, like I said earlier, was I don't want to be the black guy in Les Misérables. If I'm going to be in it, let us tell the truth about what an integrated society actually looks like.
Was there a possibility of that when you were brought on?
I'm not going to go into a project and assume right. that everyone has my perspective. I'm very glad they approached me, but I needed to check. I needed to understand, you know, what the thinking was there, because it is whether I want to admit it or not, it's a big move, you know, me in that role. The other thing for me was distribution. You know, I don't want anything that's going to take me away from my house for more than 2 days better be worth it. And so, you know, I wanted to talk to them about how this thing was going to be disseminated, and PBS is proving to be a wonderful partner with this. But I had to ask the tough questions, because you don't do this work without a desire for it to be widely seen.
So had you read the book when you?
No.
So did you sit down with it immediately after?
I looked at the sheer doorstoppiness of it and avoided it for as long as I could, and then dove in, and then was, you know, completely taken by just how incredible a piece of literature it is.
And the filmmaker is a TV guy from the UK?
Tom Shanklin.
Historically?
Yeah. He's done mostly TV. Just brilliant. I mean, did all 6 episodes and had such a handle on the material. Couldn't be asked a question he didn't have an answer for in relation to every character, every location, every circumstance. And this is a film, it's a 6-hour film, basically, that goes through several years. I mean, Dominic West, who plays Jean Valjean, and I really age, you know, where we're sort of younger men at the beginning and we're fully gray and, you know, with broken bodies by the end of it. And for Tom, our director, to have such a handle on all of that was so key, because my second day of filming was my penultimate scene of the whole thing. Dominic was...
It's amazing how that happens.
Oh, it was so... But this was the most egregious yet for me, because Dominic was shooting The Affair. He had another 2 weeks on it. So I went in and had to do 2 weeks without him. And so, you know, there are scenes at the very end, the 6th episode, that don't involve him that we had to shoot. And my goodness, you know, you always have to really map the emotional journey of a character, but boy, did we have to do it on that one. But you cannot do it devoid of a great director's eye, because you will make mistakes, and he was just brilliant with that.
So have you watched the movie?
I have.
Because you were a producer, because you would watch, do you watch everything you do, ultimately?
I do watch everything I do. I mean, I know some actors don't. I learn a lot from watching my performances. I also am still so shocked by the fact that I get to do this. So getting to watch anything I've done, especially if it's on a big screen, is, I completely geek out over that. But you know, I'm a producer on this, so I was watching every cut that comes in and giving notes and just making sure that we honed it right. So it was kind of a different relationship. I've seen it several times in several permutations. But yeah, I love watching stuff I'm in, good, bad, and ugly, because I'm just so kind of shocked that I get to do it.
It kind of seems like a new apex for your authority as authority performances. You also do comedies.
Right.
They've not been as successful, unfortunately.
Right.
But it does seem like you want that range, that this is kind of the ultimate version of you. That, you know, you fit perfectly. I mean, it doesn't feel. I mean, obviously you're conscious of the race issue, but the performance, it feels like you could not think of a better person to play this role in this movie.
Well, I appreciate you saying that, and yeah, I mean, I do want to do everything. I mean, Daniel Day-Lewis is my absolute hero. You cannot predict what a Daniel Day-Lewis performance is going to be, or what kind of film he's going to be in next or whatever. I love that. You know, the actors I admire the most have that quality, whether it's Cate Blanchett or it's, you know, they just go to these places that are exciting. And I always am looking for opportunities to scare myself. Bringing complexity and depth to a character who has such an acerbic, fastidious, uncompromising goal, which is to destroy another human being. How do you make that feel engaging over 6 episodes? And that was a terrifying prospect, but I also knew that that had to be what that character is, otherwise it fails. So, you know, regardless of what I do, I just want to do things that I hitherto haven't done, that scare me, and that are going to make me a better actor. And the other thing that I've also learned, more so now than ever, is that even if it doesn't succeed, ultimately, trying to be good in whatever you do is the way to a long career. And I think that great directors aspire to actors who are going to challenge them by virtue of the kind of performances they tend to do, which are varied. So, you know, I'm always looking to do that as well.
So do you feel boxed in at all at this point?
No, I don't. Because I create so much of the content I'm in. So I anything I make or I'm a part of producing is because it's an itch I want to scratch. And thankfully, I've been given and am able to create enough of those opportunities that offset the stuff that comes in that I say no to a lot of things. And then every now and again, I'm in the middle of shooting Peter Rabbit 2 at the moment, which is, you know, a departure. It's a comedy. It's a family movie. But it's also a part of me. I have 4 kids, and I loved the first one, and I get to play this really, really fun role in it. And, you know, that just came my way. Gringo came my way, and it was written as a white character, but I was able to bring myself to it. You know, I was able to play him as a Nigerian immigrant, and that in Nigeria, I can't move for people wanting Gringo too. Right. You know, and that means so much to me, is that, yes, it was, and actually, it's one of their more successful films on the platform, on Amazon Prime. So you just never know where it's going to ultimately go. But the thing you can be in control of, in a sense, is trying to keep the audience engaged by virtue of them not being able to predict what you're going to do next.
Well, and certainly in Gringo, a director who kind of wanted you to play at farce speed and bounce off the walls.
Yeah, which I love.
Which I imagine doesn't come up for you much.
No, which I loved. And I want to do more of, you know. I really, really enjoyed that. And I love Nash Edgerton. And I love that film. And so many people do love that film. And, you know, it's... I just love the fact that we're now in an era where, you know, a film or a TV, it might not be critically acclaimed, but actually what these other windows, whether it's streaming or VOD, it's democratized things whereby people go, well, I don't know what Rotten Tomatoes is, but what's that? You know, and that's kind of amazing.
So do you feel hopeful about the future? Do you feel like you're just got your head down and you're doing the work and what comes and you'll do that part of it?
I feel very hopeful. I feel very hopeful. We have a world in which Black Panther exists, Ava DuVernay exists, where Wonder Woman exists, where my kids are getting to watch things that I didn't, getting to see representation that I didn't. And I'm watching it become normal for them. When I got Queen of Katwe and I told my son about it, the first thing he said to me when he heard it was a Disney movie is, are you going to be the best friend? That was the first thing he said to me. And that very same company was the company that gave Lupita and I the opportunity to do Queen of Katwe. And it's that same company that are that have done Black Panther, and that's a paradigm shift for my children and certainly my grandchildren. So I'm incredibly hopeful, and I'm being afforded, you know, Les Mis is the kind of opportunity I simply would not have been afforded. If I were, I would be living in the UK still. Mm. That's just the fact of the matter, because I would be being fed, I would be being nourished as a creative in the place where I'd chosen to call home. I'm now an American citizen, I'm raising American children, I'm now here, I'm very happily so, but it was a byproduct of not being nourished enough. That has changed. So I'm incredibly, not only hopeful, but I'm passionate about the future, because in a very small drop in the ocean way, I get to be a part of shaping it by virtue of being a producer and having been involved with seminal work that was part of the conversation that is, you know, helping to move things forward.
It is kind of amazing that Disney, as the company that makes the big movies, the biggest movies now, is the company that actually opened the door for more women directors this year than any other studio. And they kind of took that step without anybody. They're the only company you couldn't like push. Mm. And yet they decided to take that step.
They were pushed. They were pushed.
They were pushed.
They were pushed.
Well, Marvel certainly also part of it.
They were pushed by society. Mm. You know, if they're wise and they want people to embrace them, what you have to understand as a brand in the modern world is I need to see your brand and feel like I have ownership of it. That's my brand. That's my logo. That's my jam. That's my people. That's my community. If you can make me feel that, you have direct access to my wallet. Mm. And they are wise enough to know that. So it's not something they did out of the benevolence of their hearts. This is the thing we've been trying to say for a long time. It's good business. It's good business to employ and encourage and platform half the population, which is women. Mm-hmm. It's good business. You want to do that. You know, we're going to go and see Captain Marvel today. And my wife is the driver for that. She was like, oh, let's all go and do something together. That's my wife. She wants to do that because also, you know, she wants my sons to see that. So let's not get it twisted. They're doing good business, and we all just need to do good business. It just happens to be the right thing at the same time.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
On a Sunday afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.